and Jalen McCleskey is the slot receiver. And between the two, they have caught a lot of balls from Mason Rudolph. Now on the other side, Kansas State, they asked their quarterback, junior Jesse Ertz, to do almost the complete opposite.
Yeah, he's their leading rusher. Let's take a look at how he gets to that point in terms of he's beat up at this point in season two, but watch his physicality here. Here's a speed option, a chance to watch the type of hits that he gets and he takes and gives out too. Then there's some trickeration involved. Watch the fake pass. It really becomes a quarterback sweep. It's about getting the defense's eyes in the wrong place. And then the sleight of hand, he's as good as anybody in terms of that. Here is the zone read. Coming off his best game last week, rushed for over 100 yards, gets the ball in the end zone. He's the main cog in that offense.
The Wildcats take the field in front of the 32nd straight sellout crowd here in Manhattan. A crowd well known for being really hard on visiting teams. They're ready to cheer their Wildcats on against Oklahoma State. And the kickoff is next. Oklahoma State and Kansas State on a beautiful day in the Little Apple, getting ready to kick off today. Big 12 play for the Cowboys. Their season so far, of course, that controversial loss to Central Michigan in non-conference play. And then they lost a game to then 16th-ranked Baylor, or now 16th-ranked Baylor, in a game where they turned the ball over four times. The big win over West Virginia last week, and that's how the Cowboys come in to Manhattan today. For more, let's go downstairs. Here's Chris Button.
Well, and you talk about that big win over West Virginia as Oklahoma State handed them their first loss of the season. I asked Mike Gundy last night, what is your final message to the team? And he said, it's actually the same thing as if they had lost that game. You had 24 hours to think of it. It's time to move on. He also reminded his guys, you can't be overconfident because Bill Snyder Family Stadium is such a tough place to play. As for Kansas State, they still have a lot to play for because even though the chances are very, very small, they have a shot at the Big 12 title. And to give his team a little extra motivation, Coach Snyder showed some quotes to his team that said this Oklahoma State was going to pass all over their defense. Well, Jordan Willis, defensive end for the Wildcats, told me, we know that's our weakness, and that was just the motivation we need to fix that today.
Experienced coach like Bill Snyder would never use a little bulletin board material, would he?
Locker room inferno, that's what we call it. Light it up.
Here's the story of the Wildcats season so far. The opener, a close game to Stanford, losing to West Virginia and Oklahoma, two highly ranked teams. And so they try and see if they can defend their home turf, something they've been very good at over the years, against Oklahoma State today. Unseasonably warm today here in the Little Apple, 73 degrees for a November kickoff in Manhattan.
I think they're giving me credit for bringing the weather. Usually when I was at Oregon, if it rained, they give me credit for the weather. But here, it's a good day. I like that.
Lots of students out. The student section is jammed. Been very impressed with the student turnout, the size of the student section here, and the history between them. 63rd meeting all time between the two schools. The home team has won the last five straight. That would favor certainly the Wildcats today. But again, Oklahoma State coming in as the 18th ranked team in the country and looking to keep pace with their cross-state rival. Cowboys won the toss. They have deferred, so Wildcats will get the ball first. Kicking game has been a big factor for both teams this year. Kansas State, one of the best in the nation at kick and punt returns. Oklahoma State, one of the best in the nation at defending kick and punt returns. So we'll see how that plays out as we go. Ben Brogan to kick for Oklahoma State. And it will sail out of the end zone. And the Wildcat offense will take over on the touchback at their 25-yard line. So Jesse Ertz, the junior from Burlington, Iowa, comes onto the field, set a new career high for rushing yards in a game last week, 6'3", 212 pounds. A rushing quarterback, when you get to November, you sort of hinted at, can get a little beaten up by this time of the year. Any player can in college football. But Ertz is a tough one, and he'll have that ball tucked under his arm a lot today.
He's a great decision maker. His arm is dropping a little bit in terms of the throws because I think he's gotten beaten up just a little bit, but he's their leading rusher now. He's the thing that makes his offense go.
Fullback is 38, Winston Dimmel. The tailback is Charles Jones, 24. And the first play from scrimmage for the Wildcats. Nothing doing. Strung out and blocked up by the middle of that Oklahoma State offensive front. Jarrell Owens, 93 there. Mote Miley, 90 was there. Vincent Taylor, 96 was there. There's some big ones.
There is. And what you'll see is Kansas State rarely huddles. They sort of muddle huddle. And then they'll come out and spend a lot of time at the line of scrimmage trying to figure out what is the best play. They'll get that from the sideline. And then Ertz also has the opportunity to change the play at the line of scrimmage. A lot of their plays involve the run-pass option where the quarterback makes a decision based on what the defense does.
And they're off to Jones. Finds a seam, gets out close to the 40-yard line before Jordan Stearns knocks it down, and the Wildcats move the chains.
This is all about keeping the ball. They're a very good team in terms of running the football. They don't throw it a lot. They don't actually rack up that many yards, but they take a lot of time off the clock with every possession, so it puts a lot of pressure on the other team.
K-State's rushing offense, the focus of their offense against one of the better rushing defenses. The pass game defense has been what's been difficult. It's been difficult for both teams. Here's Ertz with some room. Across midfield before he's knocked down.
They're going to get a heavy dose of quarterback run today. We talked with the defensive coaches. Coach Spencer at Oklahoma State said he's got to try to find a way to get an extra guy in the box to stop the quarterback run. But doing it so that Kansas State can't see where it's coming from is the key.
So down to the 47-yard line of Oklahoma State on the opening possession. For some room behind his fullback, Dimmel. A nice play to work his way through some of the blocking by Jordan Burton. 20 for Oklahoma State. Came up from his Sam linebacker position to make the stop.
Jesse Ertz is looking at the two deep safeties for Oklahoma State. If they stay back, he's going to run the football. But notice his eyes stayed down the field. If they come up and try to fill with a safety, he's going to try to attack that gap area with a receiver that'll occupy that space.
You'd take 5 yards on first down all day long, wouldn't you?
Exactly. That's a very successful offense to me.
How about another five for Charles Jones?
Right now, I like the mix they're doing with quarterback run and then tailback run. They're doing a great job of keeping the Oklahoma State defense off balance.
So a first down for K-State. This time they send three receivers out to the far side, yet to throw the ball. And down
surprise.
To the 37-yard line.
No surprise on that.
Yeah, exactly. Ertz will follow Dimmel up through the hole. And another big chunk on first down before Burton knocks him down.
They love Winston Dimmel. They think he's one of the toughest guys on this football team. His collisions don't, they are a running start type of collision. They're a car crash type thing happening.
Dimmel, the sophomore from here in Manhattan. He is the son of the co-offensive coordinator, Dana Dimmel, of K-State. He's lined up here in fullback in the I formation with Jones behind him. Ertz under center.
Looks like a blitz coming from Oklahoma State. Let's see if they change the play.
Good second effort by Jones. He was hit right in the hole by Devontae Averett, but bounced outside to get a couple. So we set up third down here. They need about one.
Yeah, third and short early in the game is a shot opportunity if you want it. Sometimes you want to get the first down first.
On the quarterback sneak. And it should have enough for it to move the chains and keep the drive going.
They're pretty good at the quarterback sneak. They've done it with three backs in the backfield where you can use the push technique. That was more just the quarterback on a one-on-one situation with the sneak. That was line push up front.
So their fourth first down on this drive. It's already some 4 minutes long. And the ball now down to the 26-yard line of Oklahoma State.
The play clock down under 5 seconds.
Oh, down to the 20-yard line for Charles Jones, the senior from Mandeville, Louisiana. He's 10th in the Big 12 in yards per carry, averages about 5 per carry, and he got a little more than that on that one.
Vintage Bill Snyder, take time off the clock, get in the right play, dominate the game in terms of time of possession, and find a way to score points on every opportunity.
Got a blocker in front. Nice fight off of that block by Ramon Richards to save a touchdown, but Charles Jones has the Wildcats down to inside the 10-yard line.
Great job by Reed Niver, the center, pulling out, leading that play, got outside, did a great job.
Niver, the junior from Spring, Texas, 67.
Take a look. He's going to snap the ball and then pulls out to the right. Good job initially. He gets his way through. That's a big guy that can pick up his feet and be very nimble in the open field.
Again, nice job by Richards to fight that block off. Gave up some yardage, but saved the touchdown. So first and goal from the 9. Touchdown, Kansas State, Jesse Ertz. If you're Bill Snyder, that is how you draw up an opening drive to a game.
He couldn't have done any better. If you ask him to draw it up, that's exactly what you would see.
The regular point after kicker for the Wildcats, Matthew McCrane, is injured. He's been banged up a little bit, so Ian Patterson is in, the senior from Columbia, Missouri, to kick the point after. It's a live ball. No, it should be a live ball. Hit the upright, right? I was wondering why there weren't any whistles going. So the point
the
after try
no
goes
good.
Off the upright.
We need a timeout.
And so they'll get 6 instead of 7. But an opening touchdown drive for K-State gets them on the board. On the marquee of Varney's Theater in Aggieville, just across from campus, welcome to Manhattan, Coach.
Yeah. I don't ever have to have a worry about a bullet. I couldn't grow my hair that long.
So. Well, now Coach Gundy's offense for Oklahoma State will get its chance to try and even up or go ahead after the very successful opening drive by K-State. 11 plays, 2 people touched the ball. Quarterback ran it 5 times, halfback ran it 5 times, and the missed point after it's 6-0 for Kansas State. So here comes Mason Rudolph, the junior from Rock Hill, South Carolina, which is just at the North Carolina-South Carolina border, kind of a suburb of Charlotte. He is 10th in the nation in passing yards per game, 15th in the nation in passing efficiency, and he hasn't thrown an interception in 4 straight games. He's only thrown 2 all season.
2 out of over 290 pass attempts. He is very accurate. He sees the field very well. He's got great visual acuity.
Justice Hill, the freshman, is the setback for the Cowboys. Rudolph's going to throw, got a receiver. Here's McCluskey, and he's all the way out off across the 45-yard line before he's knocked down. So Jalen McCluskey, the sophomore from Covington, Louisiana, limping a little bit after the hit he took on that knockdown, has a big chunk for the Cowboys on their first play.
And they're going to go fast. They want to go fast. Sometimes they have to wait for substitution or personnel. Most of the time, they're more comfortable going at speed.
Rudolph will dump it off into the flat. Not much going there for James Washington. Well sniffed out by Donnie Starks. 10 for Kansas State. Second down. There's James Washington. Sorry, Coach. The junior from Stamford, Texas.
He's more of a guy I want to see go downfield because he's got speed, he's got range, he's got the ability to leap. So he's the guy you want to throw the deep ball to or something over the middle where he can jump up and get it.
Yeah. Handoff, throw near side. What a catch. Was it good? Yes. All the way out to Juwan Seals, who really acrobatically reached up, pulled that in, and got a foot down.
This is a pro throw. What we're talking about, from the hash mark to the opposite sideline, down the field.
Tried for the same thing, but did not get the foot down this time, and incomplete.
A little bit too high, but you see the warp speed. They do not want to let you substitute. When they substitute, the officials have to let them. But the reality is they want to go faster and more comfortable. I think Mason Rudolph gets in a rhythm with his receivers when he can go at speed.
This is Hill with his first carry, and it's a big one. Justice Hill, the freshman from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Sixth in the Big 12 in rushing yards per game, and he got another good one there.
Pretty much explode on the scene, but he's also happy that Chris Carson is going to be back this game. Give him a little break. Carson's a bigger, more sturdy back for pass protection, but he'll give Justice the ability to stay fresh into the fourth quarter.
So third and very short. They bring in a couple of tight ends. Blake Jarwin and Zach Veach come in for the Cowboys. Let's see if they come to the line and snap quickly.
It's like a power set.
Whistles.
I'm not sure they had 11 men on the field. I think they're looking at saying, wait a second, guys.
Timeout. Oklahoma State. First of the half. Media timeout.
All right, take a break with a third and one coming up for the Cowboys when we come back.
College football, presented by K Jewelers. For 100 years, every kiss begins with K. And in part by Buick, proud partner of the NCAA. And by the Venture Card from Capital One. Earn unlimited double miles you can use on any airline, anytime.
About an hour and 45-minute drive directly west from Kansas City on I-70. That's Aggieville, part of the beautiful community of Manhattan, Kansas. Shops, restaurants right across from campus. Maybe a few establishments students may visit when they're not otherwise studying. Third and one here for Oklahoma State. They did only have 10 men on the field. That's why they took the timeout. Rudolph too high for Washington, and it's fourth down.
Pressure in his face from Walker made him throw that pass a little bit too high. Let's see if they're going to go for it here on the road. Willing to take some chances.
Gone for it on fourth down seven times this season. Made it three. Fourth and very short.
Staying in the spread look, which means odds are it's going to be a pass.
K-State brings pressure. He's hit as he throws. Knocked away. What a defensive play by Kendall Adams. 21. For Kansas State.
Tremendous play on defense. It underscores the point. When you play Kansas State, you've got to match them points per possession. If you don't, you're going to lose that battle. Great anticipation. Drives on the ball so well. Kendall Adams sort of had an idea what play might happen. When he saw him, he just took a chance and said, I'm going to go knock that ball down.
So no points on that possession for Oklahoma State. And the Wildcats get the ball back halfway through this first quarter with a 6-0 lead. Last drive was 11 plays. Only two people touched the ball. The quarterback, Jesse Ertz, and the running back, Charles Jones. Now it's Justin Silman, 32, who's in at tailback. And Ertz to make his first passing attempt under pressure. Throws it away. He was under a lot of heat from Chad Whitner, 45, from Oklahoma State.
For intentional grounding, the quarterback is out of the pocket, and the ball by scrimmage, second down.
Whitner, one of the leaders on that defense and a big playmaker for them. Johnny on the spot, and they're getting pressure. Reality is right now in that first drive, the offensive line of Kansas State did a tremendous job, and then the decision of who's going to have the ball, the quarterback or the tailback, kept Oklahoma State off balance.
Ertz going to throw again, near side, Deontay Burton, and a flag comes in. Lindsey Pipkins, four for Oklahoma State, was defending. Our Big 12 officiating crew today led by referee Scott Campbell.
Pass interference, number four, defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
Fortunate to get the call here. Pretty well thrown pass right in the vicinity where he could catch it. You see the pushing and the little bit of the arm bar there. The reality is, too, when you have a negative play on first down, incomplete, have to throw the ball away. Even Kansas State has to consider throwing the ball on second down, which I really don't like.
So the penalty yardage gets him across midfield, down to the 48-yard line of Oklahoma State, and a fresh set of downs. Sermon with his first carry. Grind for a couple, not much there. Justin Sillman, the sophomore from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Former walk-on. And had nine carries in their game a week ago against Iowa State for 54 yards and a touchdown.
Much better up front effort. Vincent Taylor and the group up front have to do a great job of occupying gaps, canceling gaps, because with the quarterback run game involved, you have to make sure you've got a guy for all eight of the gaps up front.
Numbers thrown a little too tall for Deontay Burton on the outside, and it's incomplete, sets up third down and long.
This is not exactly where Kansas State would like to be. Jesse Ertz is only completing about 55% on the season. Although he came back last week almost 65%, had one of his better throwing games.
So you see on the first drive, very successful with all the running plays. Now a couple of passes and haven't gained anything on them. And it's third down and eight here for the Wildcats. Some extra bodies picked up nicely with time. Ertz throws, got a receiver wide open, complete. Dominique Heath has the ball, and Kansas State is down inside the 15 at the 14.
It's hard to believe that that guy got that open. Let's take a look at how it happened. Here you can see somebody busted coverage. The top of the coverage got confused on who had the deep third. They cross receivers, comes wide open. Give Ertz credit that he saw it and put the ball in the money.
Looked like Trey Flowers, 31, got turned around for Oklahoma State. So now down to the 14-yard line. And a first down for Ertz and the Wildcats. They get about four down to the 10-yard line.
That's a great example of the run-pass option. See the quarterback had two hands on the ball, and his eyes were down the field. The line was blocking run, but the receivers are all trying to get open. If somebody broke open down the field, he'd have thrown that football. They would much rather throw on first down than third down. They'd like to avoid the obvious pass situations.
You see that the Wildcats have been phenomenal once they get into the red zone at putting points on the board. 34, Alex Barnes is into the game now at the halfback position to the left of Ertz and in the Wildcat spot. And with the ball and coming into the end zone is Dibble. Touchdown, Kansas State. There's your trickeration.
Wow, I'm impressed. All-purpose young man right there. Block, carry, and catch.
Winston Dibble, the sophomore from here in Manhattan, took the direct snap, ran it in for his eighth touchdown of this season. And now the point after try. Remember that Ian Patterson, the senior from Columbia, Missouri, bounced it off the left upright last time. And the regular kicker, Matthew McRain, a little banged up, did not warm up before the game. There's through. And so a 13-point lead for the Wildcats at home. Direct snap. The body count worked in favor of the Wildcats. And into the end zone for the second touchdown of the day, Kansas State. Six plays, 63-yard drive, 2 minutes and 15 seconds. Kansas State with its second touchdown of the day and a 13-0 lead for the Wildcats here in the first quarter in Manhattan. touchback, and Oklahoma State will start from its 25-yard line. Taco Bell, a proud partner of the college football playoff. Be on the lookout for Taco Bell student sections and passionate fans like these at games all season long. Singing the Wabash Cannonball just before the game started. One of the traditions here that goes back to about 1968. Apparently there was a fire that destroyed the home of the music department, and the Wabash Cannonball was the only music sheets they had left.
Thank God they saved it, because I love that song.
It's what they did, and it's become a tradition, and they've gotten to sing it a couple of more times already today after two K-State scores. So can Oklahoma State answer? Mason Rudolph to throw. Jalen McCluskey will have the completion, and we'll check in the studio with Cassidy Hubbard.
Thanks, Alan. Taco Bell studio update number 11, Florida at Arkansas. Gators first possession. Luke Del Rio picked off by Santos Ramirez, and he takes off for the pick six. They've also tacked on another touchdown. Arkansas 14-0.
All right, Cassidy, and here at Kansas State. Oklahoma State going fast. Chris Parson with his first reception of the day. They move the chains at a first down for the Pokes. Not much doing there up the middle.
Kansas State doing a great job right now of taking the middle away. Notice all the throws have been to the outside. The runs inside are getting canceled. They're doing a great job of making Mason Rudolph throw where he doesn't want to throw. He wants to throw vertical seam throws down the middle of the field. He's not getting them.
One of the things that Mike Gundy told us they wanted to do was play from in front. And now they're behind a couple of scores. Are the Cowboys second down and 9. Rudolph's got a man downfield. Caught! Juwan Seals with a big game for the Cowboys, and they're deep into Kansas State territory.
Coach talked about Seals being one of the leaders on this team, but more for his blocking. There he becomes the deep receiver. Huge catch, which puts them in scoring territory.
And here's Justice Hill. With just a couple is the ball out. Will stay in Oklahoma State possession. These two teams have been good at creating turnovers, not necessarily giving them up. Close call there for the Cowboys. And we may be getting our first video review of the day.
The rolling offense, the previous play.
All right, so essentially, the previous play is under review. Jeff Hansen is the Big 12 replay official today. Did the ball come out?
Ball's out for sure.
But was it, were his knees down?
Well, that's a good point. Yeah.
Is there indisputable video evidence beyond all doubt? The call on the field was Oklahoma State ball.
Yeah, it's difficult to see where his knee is down. And
ball's moving there.
Yeah. We can't see his knee at that point. Maybe we can get another look that would show that knee down in terms of where the position of the ball. Yeah, so the ball definitely came out late, but the question is whether his knee was down with possession of the ball.
And there is Justice Hill, the Oklahoma State running back, on the training table behind the bench. So we'll keep an eye on that as he got twisted up in that pile.
He's only about 180 pounds.
I don't know that there's enough to overturn it.
I would agree with you. I can't see enough there to make an indiscreet.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Back it down.
Yep. And again, the terminology there, stands, means not enough evidence to overturn it. So the ruling on the field is what you go with. If they'd said confirmed, then there was enough evidence to confirm the decision, or they'd have reversed it. So the Cowboys into the red zone. Down at the Kansas State 13-yard line. And a second down here.
And the pressure to get a touchdown, not a field goal.
Yeah, very much, huh? Rudolph dumps it off. McCluskey was coming across over the middle. Gets a block and into the end zone inside the pylon for a touchdown.
That was pretty close to a block in the back. I think they got away with one there. Nice execution on the play.
Watch 81 Juwan Seals as McCleskey angles toward the pylon. First, the underneath dump off.
You can see it. This is a crossing route underneath. Nice job. Nice throw by Rudolph. Hits him right on stride. And then watch right here. Yeah, this is tough, and you can't see exactly where. If he struck the side, the arm, or whatever, it's totally legal. There was no flag thrown. You can't come back and look at that anywhere.
Ben Grogan for a noisy point after try.
The natives are restless.
And Oklahoma State is on the board, trailing now by six. So the Cowboys answer. 3 minutes to go, first quarter in Manhattan. Jalen McCleskey gets the touchdown for Oklahoma State to bring him back within six and get the Cowboys on the board. Six plays, 75-yard drive, and even 2 minutes it took. And, of course, the big 48-yard pass completion to Juwan Seals, the key play on that drive for the Pokes. So can their defense get off the field without allowing Kansas State another long, successful scoring drive? Pringle waits in his end zone, and he will let Amendola's kick go over his head, and they'll start with the touchback at the 25. Our AT&T Inside Access brings you inside the new Kansas State Athletic Facilities. Whether you're in the lobby of the main office building or you're walking through the tunnel going out to the field, Bill Snyder's 16 goals for success are everywhere. They're on a plaque on the statue outside the stadium. It is it's the verbiage by which they live.
Well, I think you can never say it enough and teach young men, you know, the best way to lead their lives. And it's not just about football. It's about being successful in life.
So from the 25-yard line is where the Wildcats of Mr. Snyder will start. Jesse Ertz under some heat. Gets away, gets the edge. He'll get eight on that first down play.
Hurst is sneaky fast. The defense thought they had him for a huge gain, and he just turned on his jets and got outside.
So there are those 16 goals for success.
You know, I think all of us, the longer we coach, do we come up with some ideas. I call it the Ten Commandments, whatever you want to say. It's just about how to live your life, how to be successful. As I said before, it's not just about football. It's about going out in the real world and being successful in life.
You had win the day that you came up with at Oregon.
I had a few other things that said that led up to win the day, too. But.
Coming on the end around. Byron Pringle across the 40 before he stacked up and stopped. How'd you get to win the day?
Well, we had about five or seven phrases that embodied a lot of what Coach Snyder's principles were, but we found out it was too hard to remember them all. It's too hard to talk about them all. Just say, win the day encompassed the whole idea that do all that stuff every single day. And it was whether you're in the classroom, in the community, on the football field, it didn't really matter. Win the day embodied the whole thing.
Bill Snyder has certainly put those 16 principles to good use here in Manhattan. So successful over the years. Approaching his 200th victory. Dump pass here to Isaiah Zuber, and he'll be out across the 45. And set up a short play needed for K-State to continue this drive.
I always say those passes are really elongated runs. Those type of throws that are out of beyond the line of scrimmage just barely are just a form of the running game for Kansas State.
Marked him a couple of yards, a little bit more back than I expected. So it's second and six. Ertz goes out wide. It's Pringle this time. It'll take the direct snap. Except the ball wasn't snapped when everybody else started moving.
That happens when you get in that Wildcat situation. The cadence is different by the quarterback.
So they'll back him up five.
False start. Number 61. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
Second reminds you about the huge Big Ten game coming up tonight on ABC. Number 10 Nebraska and number 6 Ohio State in Columbus. Both teams 7-1, so a lot of college football playoff implications in this one. 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific on ABC. Of course, streaming on the ESPN app and on Watch ESPN. Who you like?
I like Ohio State. They have not played well lately, but I think they're a better football team than Nebraska.
Hard to pick them against them at home. If it was in Lincoln, I might think about that one a little more. Ertz will get dropped for a loss. Mote Mile eventually caught up to him, had good pressure, but no place to go with the ball. And by the time he tried to find a running route, Mile closed it up.
That was a great job by the coverage of Oklahoma State. You saw Ertz had a lot of time, decided at the end to scramble, and still didn't get back to the line of scrimmage. So it sets up third and long, which is, as we've talked about before, this puts a lot of stress on Ertz's arm because he's not totally healthy. That's not his forte. He'd rather be throwing on first down when he wants to throw.
They need the Oklahoma State 48-yard line. No place to go. And he'll step out of bounds at the 45. There is a flag down in the backfield. Might be tacking on a holding penalty on this one.
That was just a three-man rush. Oklahoma State chose to play coverage in the back end. Dropped eight.
Holding, number 74, offense. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Scott France is the left tackle for the Wildcats, number 74.
And that's not a good thing that happens. You know, when you are, look, take a look on the outside here. When you're only rushing three, you should have guys there. And he's got the headlock.
First quarter.
So after the declining of the penalty, they let the clock run out on the first quarter. We'll start the second with a K-State punt. Good start for the Wildcats, and then the Cowboys answered. End of one, it's a six-point ball game in the Little Apple. Now that may be the most creative sign I've ever seen, tying in the Cubs ending the World Series curse with Coach Snyder here in Manhattan. You'll only get that here at Kansas State.
I love that, because usually I'm the victim of that type of thing. But I'll tell you what, Coach Snyder is an institution, tradition.
Real fun. So K-State opens the quarter by punting the ball into the end zone. And Oklahoma State will come out with the touchback. Reminder to kick off your NFL Sunday with us on ESPN, 10 a.m. Eastern. NFL Insider Sunday Edition brings you all the early breaking stories and injury news. Then at 11, Sunday NFL Countdown takes you up to kickoff. Both shows, of course, streaming live on ESPN's app and on Watch ESPN. The credentials of our new Sunday Countdown crew. That's a lot of rings in that group.
So far, James Washington has been conspicuous in his absence from the offense. Let's see if they can get him involved.
That's one of the things that offensive coordinator Mike Yurcich said to us about defenses. If they lock down on 28, Mr. Outside, then it opens up Mr. Inside, McCleskey. Rudolph's throw to the aforementioned James Washington. And he's got some nice yardage out to the 32-yard line on his first grab of the day.
Once again, one of those throws that showcases the arm strength of Mason Rudolph.
Check that, his second grab of the day, beg your pardon. It'll rumble for about four by 32. Chris Carson missed a month earlier with a broken hand. This is third game back, a welcome sight for the Oklahoma State offensive staff. I thought the freshman Justice Hill was getting banged around and carrying the ball a little too much for a true freshman. Carson again out close to first down yardage.
We've also talked about the fact that Carson brings a bigger presence to the pass protection mode, over 215 pounds. He can pick up a linebacker coming on a blitz.
Washington, good hands and a good step to get the first down. How about that from James Washington?
That was good hand-eye coordination. He actually transferred the ball. He also saw the peripheral vision to see the defender coming and make the move. So pretty impressive.
Yeah, it was. Really, really nice football play. So out to the 46-yard line and a fresh set of downs. Rudolph looking downfield. Got a runner wide open. Blake Jarwin headed for the end zone. Touchdown, Oklahoma State.
Empty set puts a lot of stress on the defense.
How about caught the big tight end rumbling down for the long ball.
Well, a perfectly thrown pass, and they attacked the defense. They went to an empty set, got him down the seam, which was a perfectly executed play.
54 yards. The catch and run from Rudolph to Blake Jarwin, and now the point after try coming from Ben Grogan to give the Cowboys their first lead of the ball game. Reviewing the touchdown,
maybe
potentially.
Where his knee went down, possibly.
Well, the game clock operator, please reset the game clock. 13:42. 13 minutes, 42 seconds.
Okay. So, we'll line up again to try this point after. And again, it is Ben Grogan, the senior from Arlington, Texas, the Big 12 leader in scoring this season. And he knocks it right down the middle. Well, 54-yarder from Mason Rudolph to 248-pound tight end Blake Jarwin. And the Cowboys have the lead. After Kansas State jumped out to a 13-0 lead, Oklahoma State has roared back with two touchdowns to lead by one. Just inside the second quarter here in Manhattan, Alan Bestwick, College Football Hall of Famer Mike Bellotti, Chris Budden at field level for us, and the ball falling off the tee, and we'll try to run up again. Think about this. Oklahoma State has more than half of their total yards in this game on two plays.
That's all you need.
Pass plays.
When you're an explosive team, that's all you need.
So Matt Amendola will try again to kick the ball deep. So far today, he's been kicking him out of the end zone. Into the wind this time. We'll get a return from Byron Pringle. Stopped shy of the 20-yard line. Let's go back and look at that touchdown again. Something had to go wrong for him to be that wide open.
Well, they had an empty set, and they ran some verticals here. This guy sort of did a screen, and they do this, and they're going here. But really, it's this young man who sort of gets caught in between there. As we watch this thing develop, it's just a vertical route. He sort of looks at the quick screen inside there and then gets caught, and they just got too many guys going down the field. It puts a lot of stress on the top end of the defense.
Blake Jarwin's long reception on the season to this point had been 23 yards. That went for 54 and his first receiving touchdown of the year.
Congratulations. That was good. He didn't have to move either. Just keep going, running a straight line.
You got that kind of freight moving downhill like that. It was going to be hard to stop anyway. So K-State has the ball at their own 20-yard line.
Like the Wabash Cannonball, right?
That's it. Jesse Ertz dancing around looking for a seam, and he almost found one. That was going to save a big chunky yardage when Jordan Stearns got a hand on a shoe tip for Oklahoma State.
He's done a great job this year of making quick decisions about the run pass option. There he had to hold it for a long time, whether he got confused by what the defense showed him. But the reality is the offensive front line could not hold their blocks that long.
One more step quickly through that hole, and Ertz had a lot of grass in front of him, a lot of turf. Anyway. Completion to Dominique Heath, set up a third down and short for the Wildcats. Here's Heath, the sophomore from Huntersville, North Carolina. Hopewell High School, not all that old of a school, and you don't really think about players coming from Charlotte out to Kansas State to play, but they've got them from all kind of different parts here.
In my mind, Heath is one of the guys besides Ertz that makes this offense go. He's the guy you can throw the quick screen to. He's a jitterbug out there in the open field.
So third down here for the Wildcats. Complete for the first down. And again, it's Heath. He needs a minute to regroup after taking a good solid sock by Ashton Lampkin.
That was a chiropractic move by the defender. I'll tell you what, he racked him. This is actually a really good throw by Ertz. He puts a little mustard on this one. They got to throw it in between. You see right here, he's coming out, and then boom. It's hit pretty good. Hangs on to the football, which is the key.
It's a rib adjuster.
Go, 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 go.
Charles Jones across midfield. Foot race. Got a block. And into the end. No, wait. They're saying he stepped out at the 32. Official back at the 32. Near sideline signaling out of bounds there.
The fans don't want to know that.
There it is.
Out of bounds at the 32-yard line. First down.
Yeah, clearly.
Yeah, great job by the official right there on the spot.
Well, still an explosive.
The game clock operator, please reset the game clock. 3 seconds. And it's 43 seconds.
35-yard run anyway for Charles Jones to flip some field position. K-State's got the ball at the 32-yard line going in.
Darian Daniels, number 79, chased him all the way down the field. I was impressed by the big man with that type of effort.
Brooks throws out to Heath. Trying to work a block out toward the sideline. Good defensive play there to try and fight off the block and force him to the sideline.
And notice Heath got out of bounds that time rather than engage in contact. His ribs may still be sore from that earlier hit.
Trey Flowers there. It's that term you coaches use all the time, leverage.
Leverage.
Leverage the sideline to his advantage. How about that? I came
you're
up good. With that
I was
all by
say,
myself.
You've been right to the front of the class. I'm really proud of you.
All right, direct snap formation here. That's Pringle. Go to the short side. Is the ball out? I think the ball's out.
Rolling on the field, there's a fumble recovered by K-State. Third down.
Take a look. They couldn't get the snap off last time. He's got to protect that ball much better.
Oh, yeah.
That ball is definitely out, but luckily he and another teammate fall on it there. Dimmel, I think, between the two of them, they corral the football. I may have to eliminate that package right now. That's a fumble and a penalty so far with that package in the game.
Third down and one here. Can they convert? Or can the Pokes get a stop? Dalvin Warmack into the game, the sophomore from Blue Springs, Missouri. Very close to the first down marker, but enough to move the chains.
Skos, that was a good second effort to get that first down. Knocking on the door of the red zone.
So spotted at the 22. Warmack, a 5'8", 187-pound running back. That was his 30th carry of the season.
Power run or play action from this formation?
Good solid run. Calvin Bundage with the stop for Oklahoma State, but not before. About a 6-yard gain for K-State. And into the red zone they go.
Warmack got a little wiggle to him, a little different than Jones.
And one of the things that Bill Snyder told us when we met with him yesterday is about the usage of his running backs. They've got four, basically, that they use a lot at halfback. He's trying to figure out how to better ride the hot hand in the course of a game.
It's nice he's got four healthy running backs this time of the season.
Again, the direct snap to Pringle. And got flags down. Mote Mile and now Winston Dimmel having words.
False start. Offense. Number 6. 5-yard penalty. Take it down.
And the game taking on a chippy edge here.
They are struggling with Pringle in at the Wildcat quarterback position. Whether he's calling the cadence or the center is doing it, they are not getting off on the snap count. Once again, this is the third time with this set. They have not got a playoff yet that didn't result in a fumble or a penalty.
So back them up 5. They're almost back to the original line of scrimmage.
Sometimes you practice a package, a particular personnel group or whatever, the whole week. You think it works great in practice, you get in the game, son of a gun. Doesn't work worth a darn.
Those other guys on the other team have something to say about that.
That's right.
Womack has get just about to the 20-yard line. He's hit there by Jordan Stearns. It'll set up third down and pretty long for the Wildcats.
Womack won too many turns and twists there. At some point, you got to put your foot in the ground, lower your pad level. When you are spinning, you are not able to really generate any power to break a tackle. Third and long down here. See if Oklahoma State comes with some pressure.
Birch with plenty of time. But nobody to throw the ball, and he's finally wrapped up and dropped by Vincent Taylor, the Cowboys team leader in sacks and tackles for loss.
If you make them hold the football, Vincent Taylor's going to find you. He is big, physical, 310 pounds, and he's got a great motor. He often won't use his hands initially as much as he should, but he's relentless.
So Ian Patterson comes on to kick a field goal. This will be his first field goal try of his career. And the sixth of his of the season, rather, and the sixth of his career. Wasn't pretty, but it counts.
It was perfect in the scorebook, though.
That's his first field goal attempt since 2013. He's been primarily their kickoff guy.
He's had a lot of time to practice it, though.
College football presented by K Jewelers. Brought to you by Pacific Life, helping generations of families achieve long-term financial security for over 145 years. Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy. And Valero, the power of the American dream.
The beautiful Vanier Family Football Complex, $195 million worth, double the amount of training space for student athletes, world-class resources, equipment, and facilities, and of course, Coach Bill Snyder's 16 goals for success prominently displayed as a part of that complex. It is beautiful. There's a lot of purple in there, too.
Yeah, there is. K-State has always been on the front or the vanguard in terms of facility development. We came here in 1997, either 96 or 97, to look at their new indoor practice facility, and we modeled some of the things that we built at Oregon after what we saw here.
Well, the home team back out in front by two after the 11-play drive that resulted in the 43-yard field goal. Now Oklahoma State to get the ball back. That field goal landing at the bottom of the All-State field goal nets. The Good Hands field goal nets, part of All-State's program where they make contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds. For each field goal, an extra point kicked. All-State contributing millions in scholarship funds through that program. Other angle on that, K-State gets the points, but one of the things Oklahoma State told us they needed to do was limit Kansas State to field goals because they take so much time off the clock with the way their offense works. So that's a small victory there for the Cowboys defense. And their offense back on the field, led by Mason Rudolph. They start at the 25-yard line. He'll throw again to Blake Jarwin, who's got another big chunk of yards deep down into Kansas State territory.
Yards per catch for him today are pretty impressive so far. Nice play action pass. He's a big target. He's got soft hands. Kind of guy you like to have in your team.
Line it up quick and go. Far side, that's Chris Lacy. And he'll have good yardage before he's knocked out of bounds at the 28-yard line.
When you get the big play, then you go fast. Puts a lot of stress on the defense to get lined up and get the calls in.
Justice Hill wrapped up and dropped. That was DJ Reed got in there along with Elijah Lee.
Justice Hill, more quickness and speed than power. Difficult to take on two or three guys down the field.
So a third down here for the Cowboys after the big strike that gobbled up a lot of field position, facing a third and three.
Might we see some type of quarterback run? They don't like to run Rudolph very much, but this is a perfect situation for it.
Wasn't by design, but it's going to work. Down to the 5-yard line goes Mason Rudolph for the Cowboys.
6'5", 235 pounds. He's a big target. Here, it's just the rush gets too far up the field. He sees it, recognizes it, takes advantage of it.
So they're in business, first and goal now at the 5-yard line. 21-yard run for Mason Rudolph. His long rush on the season is 25. And hand it off to Carson. But flags and whistles.
False start. Number 60. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Right tackle Zachary Crabtree.
When you look at the stadium and that closed in and all the fans that are down there, the noise level has to affect the visiting team in terms of trying to hear the snap count.
They're pretty close to him.
And the more it affects them, the more noise you're going to get out of the crowd. Jordan Willis is their best pass rusher. He's a guy we'll take a look here. Just watch him coming from the outside. Just goes inside, just a speed rush, a little bit of power there, but he's the guy that every single time he steps on the field, coach will talk about the effort and the energy he brings.
Ninth in the nation in sacks. So now way, way back, almost at the 20-yard line for second and goal for Oklahoma State.
Get some of it back right here.
Over the top and incomplete, intended for James Washington.
Can't say they got greedy, because Washington is the guy they trust. He's a leaper. He's got range because he can go up and elevate. Couldn't quite get to that.
So third down and goal.
So the question for the quarterback is, you can't turn the ball over. You got to come away with at least a field goal, but you want to get the ball either first down range or end zone.
This is Rennie Childs trying to bounce off people. Flag comes in. Is there a face mask in there as Childs, the senior from Houston, tried to wiggle his way through the traffic?
He was signaling as if he thought somebody grabbed his face mask.
Personal foul. Face mask, number 2. Defense. Half the distance to the goal. Automatic. First down.
Massive penalty on DJ Reed.
Those automatic penalties, automatic first down penalties, kill a defense, because, and you see it right there, there's no question it was grabbed. Good call by the official, but new set of downs for Oklahoma State.
Instead of being fourth and goal here, now it's first and goal from the 6. Hand it off to Carson. Fights through, down inside the 5, knocked out of bounds at the 3. Elijah Lee, 9, was there for the Wildcats.
Kendall Adams put an exclamation point on that, too. Nice combination tackle there.
So they got half of it on first down, second and goal. Childs is back in at running back to the left of Mason Rudolph. Intended for Washington. Touchdown, Oklahoma State, James Washington.
That's the range that we talked about. He's a leaper. He can go up, has tremendous vertical jump, and you see him go high point that ball. He has the ball in his hands. There's the feet down in the end zone. Should be a touchdown.
Controlled it all the way to the ground. Had the feet down. So taking advantage of the Kansas State penalty and turning it into points, Oklahoma State now back out in front with the point after try here coming from Ben Grogan. Back and forth we go. 75-yard touchdown drive by Rudolph and the Cowboys. Beautiful campus here at Kansas State University in Manhattan. And it is a beautiful, spectacular November day. Temperature up in the 70s. And a good football game going on inside Bill Snyder Family Stadium. So Oklahoma State retakes the lead from Kansas State by 5 inside of 4 minutes to go till halftime. So now, Wildcats, ball is back in your court. Can you answer?
Not only answer, but take time off the clock, which is their MO.
So be Byron Pringle from the 9. Got a lane. Nicely chased down from behind and knocked out of bounds just outside the 35-yard line. That is where K-State will take over in a moment. Trading the lead back and forth, Oklahoma State back out in front of Kansas State by 5. 3:37 left to go until halftime. Alan Bestwick, College Football Hall of Famer coach Mike Bellotti, talked about it being a clash of styles. What have you seen so far?
Well, I think it is. Kansas State's running the football and doing a great job of possessing it, but Mason Rudolph has found his big tight end a couple times down the field. He's got McCleskey and Washington involved for touchdowns. So it's really who has the ball last and who takes advantage of points per possession.
And of course, we haven't seen any turnovers yet. That one crucial penalty on that last drive against K-State.
Don't talk about that. As a coach, you don't talk about the weather or turnovers. As soon as you do, something's going to happen.
Justin Silman, a nice, determined run on first down. We're determined to check back in the studio with Cassidy.
Thanks, Alan. The CarMex Drive What's Possible update. Number 17, Baylor, in a big hole early against TCU. Kyle Hicks, look at this run. Spins away from two defenders right there. Gets the touchdown. His second of the day. They just got a pick six. They're up 31-7 in the second. Alan, Mike, back to you.
Oh, my goodness. That's a big game in the Big 12. There's Ertz throwing near side to Isaiah Zuber. So if Baylor is beaten by TCU today, let's see, that would make Baylor 3-2 in conference play, and TCU would be 3-3 as well. It's going to be a very intriguing month of November rolls along.
The plot thickens, I was going to say.
What's at stake today? Oklahoma winning its game Thursday night. Oklahoma State needing to win today to try and stay within a game of their cross-state rival. Kansas State needs to win out in conference play to have any shot at the conference title and have a lot of other things work for them to get a shot.
But Oklahoma just needs to win out, and it's a done deal, correct?
Easier said than done, because if both teams continue to win, the Bedlam game, December 3rd, becomes a de facto conference championship game.
That's true.
So the fans not happy with the decision to
remember,
kick it away. But
both of these teams are great special teams in terms of fakes, scoring points, and that type of thing. But Coach Snyder, pretty conservative coach, in all honesty, and I wouldn't quibble with this at this point.
Look at that. Nick Walsh angles it out of bounds inside the 10-yard line. And Oklahoma State will take it over with just under 2 minutes to go. Monday Night Football in the Pacific Northwest this week. Tyrod Taylor and the Bills take on Russell Wilson and the Seahawks at 8:15 on ESPN. Coverage starts with Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's at 6. And, of course, streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Bills thumped pretty soundly by the Patriots last week, so they need a win to get back on track. Seahawks with that strange-looking tie. It's always hard to look at those standings and see the tie in the NFL standings, but they are the leaders in the NFC West and looking to stay ahead of the Cardinals as we hit the second half of the NFL season.
And there's been a bunch of ties this year. I don't know. I love the college deal, the sudden death sort of thing. Not sudden death, actually. It's just the 25. A lot of offense goes on in those overtimes.
Not kidding. Mason Rudolph, and the Cowboys try and generate some offense from deep in their own territory. That is a pretty good run by Justice Hill on first down. He'll get out to about the 11-yard line before Donnie Starks knocks him down. Last drive for the Cowboys took them 9 plays to cover 75 yards. 3 minutes and 35 seconds. They don't have that kind of time to work with. Remember that the Pokes used one of their timeouts earlier when they only had 10 men on the field. They don't appear to be in a particular hurry here.
No, I think they're actually going to let this thing run out because they have 2 timeouts, and that's enough time for them to score if they want to go warp speed. But it seems as if they're going to be content at this point to take that 5-point lead into halftime.
They will get the ball to start the second half. There's Hill again. He'll move the sticks, stop the clock while they reset the ball.
So both coaches, fairly defensive, fairly conservative. Sort of a surprise from Mike Gundy, but maybe he's learned. And I think he really has learned a lot of things from Bill Snyder over the years in terms of watching the way he has coached.
Barry J. Sanders in as the tailback here as we get down to 40 seconds to go. And hand it to Sanders. He'll get dragged down at the 21-yard line. There is a flag down in the offensive backfield.
A lot of times when you tend to be conservative because you respect the defense and you're not really going to put yourself in a situation to possibly turn the ball over.
Number 60, offense, half the distance to the goal, still first down.
Well, that's going to back up way up. Now, Kansas State still has a lot of timeouts left, all 3.
Yeah, could take some timeouts and think about trying to force them at least to have to snap the ball 3 more times.
Timeout called by Kansas State. 14 seconds left to go.
Kansas State, first to half, 30-second timeout.
Yeah, well, still second down for Oklahoma State, so.
They save that, those timeouts, though. Like I said, they're going to make them snap the ball.
Yep. All right. Well, our Pacific Life game summary. What's happened so far in this first half between the Cowboys and the Wildcats? Mason Rudolph, very efficient throwing the ball, to say the least, especially lately. Started 3 of 6. He's since gone 11 of 12 in throwing the ball.
He got hot and he found Blake Jarwin, which was
That's
a smart choice
thing.
For him.
I'm just trying to understand what's going on here. There's only 14 seconds left.
Well, they're going to run the ball and use their timeouts each time. But you're right. It's an interesting deal.
So make them punt with what, 6 seconds left? Or
yeah, just get a chance
to
punt return or a chance to block a punt, you know, that type of thing. Can you get to fourth down?
Sanders looking outside. Rudolph, the lead blocker. All the way out across the 35 to the 36-yard line with 6 seconds now left to go.
Now, I would have thought the running back would have stayed down in bounds if they're trying to run out the clock. Maybe they're going to try and get one more play that can bust it, go all the way. I'm not sure.
Get out to a certain range where you can, I don't know.
Yeah, hard.
Well, 6 seconds left. If you're going to take a shot downfield, you only have 1 shot.
Yeah, feel safe here. You're standing in the shadow of your own goalpost. That's not the most comfortable feeling.
So. Well, see, waving for him to take a knee.
Sort of interesting last minute 30 seconds here.
Yeah. Sanders will run it up the gut. And time will expire on this first half. Fairly entertaining first half. K-State jumped out to a 13-0 lead. Oklahoma State came roaring back. Then they exchanged the lead a couple times. And we go to the midway break. 21-16, Cowboys leading. Our friends in the studio break down the best of the day after this from your ABC station. feel good about for everybody at Bill Snyder Family Stadium here in Manhattan, Kansas, as we get ready to start the second half. Oklahoma State leading Kansas State by 5 on a spectacular day. Allen Bestwood College Football Hall of Famer Coach Mike Bellotti. What to feel good about? Well, the weather. It's a beautiful, beautiful day. And really, as we've tried to figure out how we got to this point, each team has done what it wanted to on offense.
There's no question. Kansas State has possessed the ball and run the ball with balance between Jesse Ertz and Charles Jones. And then on the other side, Mason Rudolph has thrown the ball, and he's found Washington and McCuskey. And Blake Jarwin has been maybe the biggest guy in the game in terms of yards per catch. But it's the difference on Jones broke a long run that looked to be an apparent touchdown. He stepped out of bounds. And on that, instead of getting a touchdown, Kansas State had to settle for a field goal.
And no real glaring adjustments to make for this second half, except if you're K-State, you've got to find a way to cover that Oklahoma State tight end. And you got to take advantage of your possessions. They had to settle for that field goal the one time. Downstairs to Chris Budden.
Allen, Mike Gundy just playing the percentages there at the end of the first half. I asked him, if you move the ball so well, you got a couple timeouts, why'd you play so conservative? And he said, at the 6-yard line against the wind, a lot more bad can happen there than good. And I trust my guys this second half to take advantage of their possessions. Also talked to Bill Snyder. He said, defensively, this is going to come down to stopping the big plays on offense. They need to get back to those first two drives. If they can play like they played there, then he says this ball game's his.
Kansas State raced out to a 13-0 lead, missed the extra point and their second touchdown. Then Oklahoma State came roaring back. Then they traded some scores at the end of that first half. So the Cowboys start with a good running play from Chris Carson, who gets about 9.5 yards, maybe an even 10. And in fact, will get 10 and get a first down on their first play from scrimmage. Cowboys go fast. Mason Rudolph throws to a wide open Jalen McCluskey. He'll get right to the line to gain before he's wrestled to the ground by Dante Barnett.
Once again, the pace of the offense puts a lot of pressure on the defense to get lined up, to communicate the defense, what you're going to do in the secondary, and then find your man. Align, assign, and execute. Very difficult against tempo offenses.
Mason Rudolph's numbers in the first half were terrific as well. 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. Again, a long, strong throw out to the far side to Juwan Seals. And a gain of about 6. That's a really terrific throw for Rudolph. A little sluggish at the start, but since then, terrific.
No, and he loves tempo. It gives him a chance to throw the receivers that are wide open in the field.
Just a little too tall for James Washington, and incomplete. And it will set up 3rd down and 4 for the Cowboys.
A lot of quarterbacks would not even attempt that type of throw. He trusts his arm. He also trusts the range of James Washington. Brings up a very manageable 3rd down here, about 4. If you see an off-coverage receiver, a guy that has a big cushion, you can throw him the ball for an easy 1st down. They keep throwing those out routes. Eventually, the DBs have done a great job of jumping those routes. I'm surprised more just to go down to the sticks and turn around, because every time you throw an out route, you run the risk that the DB could break on the ball.
DJ Reed, the sophomore from Bakersfield, California, has returned one of his 2 interceptions this year for 6.
My gosh, that could have gone the other way for a pick 6.
So Zach Seiner, the punter. Fair catch signaled for and made at about the, what was that, about the 9-yard line by Byron Pringle. How about tonight's Aflac trivia question? Bill Snyder, 11-6 against the Pokes. First meeting, 1989. Do you know who the quarterback was for Oklahoma State in that game? I think you do.
I do, but I'm not going to say.
Yeah. That's a pretty easy one. So Kansas State with its first offensive possession of this second half. They mark it at the 15. And Jesse Ertz, their junior quarterback, takes the snap. Gonna let it fly downfield. Got a wide open receiver. Underthrown. Pringle had to come back for the ball and came back a step too far and wound up being tall.
Two-move route, ran the out and up, had a play-action fake in the backfield. Let's watch a receiver. Watch him sell the out. Boom, stays his hips, sort of settles his hips. That's what the defensive back reads, and then goes up. I don't know if the sun was in his eyes or he just lost that ball, but had an opportunity to make a big play.
Hit him right in the face mask, so I'm thinking he's looking directly back into the sun as the shadows grow longer here later in the afternoon. So second and 10. Gonna run it. Justin Silman gets some yardage. And the answer to our Aflac trivia question lies on the far sideline of today's game. Quarterback of that 1989 game, Oklahoma State against Bill Snyder and Kansas State, was Mike Gundy. The game he talked about that he was beaten up and maybe shouldn't have played in and came in the second half because they were behind and wound up winning the game.
The big question, did he have a mullet back then?
Well, he had a lot of lettuce up there, I know that. Third down here for the Wildcats. Ertz is going to run for it. Just shy of the line to gain. He was stacked up there. Nicely played by Chad Whitener to keep him from falling forward. And it's fourth down.
This was a definitive tackle. Obviously, Ertz is trying. When he gets out, we're all covered down the field. He says, okay, I'm going to run it now. Can I make a move? You get the previous guy that got a piece of him took away his ability to make any type of a move on Whitener, but still a great tackle in the open field.
So nothing on the first series for the Wildcats either. Nick Walsh will kick it. Short kick. Ball's free. Kansas State gets the first turnover of the ball game.
That's a mistake when you try to run up and feel the punt.
Rolling on the field was a kick was muffed by the receiving team, recovered by K-State for a first down.
Barry J. Sanders signaled the fair catch and didn't catch up to it.
You try to save yardage by running up to catch the ball, but you've got to judge it. If you don't, get away from it. Get away from that football. Huge play.
So Elijah Lee with the recovery of the muffed kick, and the Wildcat offense comes back onto the field. They're in plus territory at the Oklahoma State 39.
Huge play, only if you can convert this to points.
Ertz throws near side. Isaiah Harris will have nothing. He was well played there. Coming up to make the stop, Derek Moncrief, the fifth-year senior from Prattville, Alabama.
This is a challenge now to the Oklahoma State defense. You've just been on the field. You got that big stop in the third quarter. Now you've got to do it again in much worse field position.
Ertz throwing the ball 7 of 10 today, 62 yards. No touchdowns, no interceptions. Justin Silman will have a lot of yards. Steps out of bounds inside the 20-yard line, getting some nice blocking downfield as well.
Nice zone blocking. Watch the offensive line. Everybody reach over a gap and just run with their blocks. Give Silman a chance to pick his hole and then get to top speed.
And Deontay Burton, the wideout, number 6. Some really good blocking on the outside to help Silman gather some more yardage. So first down now inside the 20 at the 16-yard line. Just tripped up as he gets about 9 on that first down play. Jordan Stearns with the stop for the Cowboys.
That was pretty easy. Two deep safeties. They're light in the box against quarterback run. You can't stay with two deep safeties. You're not going to have people in the box. And he was still looking. Had a safety come down late, he was going to be ready to throw the football.
Great gain on first down. So second and 1 here. Inside the 10, they can get a first down at the 6.
These last couple plays are what they started the game with. This is the core of what they do best. Pressure look coming from Oklahoma State. Looks like a change of play.
Move it off to Silman, gets hit in the backfield and dropped. Pressure, penetration, nicely played through by Devontae Everett for Oklahoma State.
If not, it should have been a change of play.
Yes, really.
They were coming with a blitz there. They had more people up front than Kansas State could block. I thought maybe they were going to audible to a one-on-one route on the outside. Did not get it done.
So they went from second and one to third and six.
Still, these are run-pass option opportunities for the quarterback.
Hurts with the shovel pass. Sniffed out well. Vincent Taylor, 96, was there for the Cowboys, and it's fourth down.
This will be a huge stop right now in terms of momentum on the game. We talked about stops or field goals, and those possessions are going to be wins for Oklahoma State.
And the field goal kicking unit comes on for the Wildcats. Missed a point after earlier. Remember, this is Ian Patterson, not the regular field goal kicker, Matthew McCrane, who has not played today. Patterson made one from 43 earlier. Gonna fake it. Too slow developing. Cowboys stop it and get the turnover on downs. Mitch Lockbieler, the holder, on the fake, but the Cowboys get the stop, and the turnover doesn't cost them any points.
All right, watch Lindsey Pipkins right there. He's going to come. They're going to try to run a power play outside here, but he does a tremendous job of, one, stepping outside, setting the edge, getting off the block, and then eventually tackling Lockbieler, the holder slash runner in that situation.
Had some help from some pursuing teammates on the inside out as well, but after the muffed punt, Kansas State with an opportunity to try and reclaim the lead. They get no points off the turnover, and Oklahoma State, ranked 18th in the college football playoff initial standings, has the ball. It's Jalen McCleskey who gets some short yardage before Dante Barnett knocks him down. Now for the Cowboys, chance to drive the field here and see if they can make it hurt.
A lot of pressure on Kansas State's defense now, because that can be, this pass series could be the turning point in the ball game. Kansas State's got to show up now.
Yeah, the momentum swing was really big there.
Coming out the first series in the third quarter, we talked a lot about the emphasis on that from both sides.
Rudolph throws, intercepted! Duke Shelley will score! Interception thrown all season by Mason Rudolph, and it cost the Cowboys six.
Talk about response and a poor throw, poor timing. See right there, the ball just overthrown on the receiver on Washington. Had no chance. Duke Shelley standing there, the gift given to him, but then he makes a great run to get the ball in the end zone.
Got his second career interception in last week's game against Iowa State. His third goes for a touchdown. And now the point after try from Ian Patterson. Is good. Back-to-back turnovers by Oklahoma State. The first one cost them nothing. The second one cost them seven. Duke Shelley, the sophomore from Tucker, Georgia, into the end zone. And Kansas State back in the lead.
College football presented by K Jewelers. Brought to you by AT&T. Mobilizing your world. Buick, proud partner of the NCAA. And Charles Schwab.
Highways, stadiums, avenues, streets, there is no way to overstate the influence that Coach Bill Snyder has had on Manhattan, Kansas, and Kansas State University. His 25th season here, approaching his 200th win, took a program that was nowhere and made it into a national powerhouse and a brand name known all across the country. I can't tell you how many college football games I watched from here in Manhattan, Kansas over the years with Coach Snyder patrolling the sidelines. His team now taking advantage of an Oklahoma mistake opportunity to reclaim the lead, and the Cowboys come back onto the field to start after the touchback. And our good hands play brought to you by Allstate was the pick six a minute ago, the fake field goal, and this whole swing that's just gone on.
That's why I love coaching. You know, you think you got something, but all of a sudden, Mason Rudolph chooses that time to throw an interception. Only the third of the year, over 300 passing attempts, but what a great play to get it back in the end zone by Shelley.
So the mood down among the purple clad after the fake field goal went nowhere. And then they get the pick six, now have the lead. And listen to the noise in this stadium as Mason Rudolph and the Cowboys offense go back to work. Jalen McCleskey pursued to the outside and captured by three purple jersey people. Elijah Lee, 9. Shermichael Moore, 52. All in on the stop.
And there were blockers out there, but not one blocker touched a defender. They whiffed in the open field. And that definitely has woken up the crowd.
Complete. Near side to James Washington. And they'll move the sticks for the Cowboys.
They're able to throw that too because Washington is good getting a decent cushion from the defender assigned to him.
Up to 37. They go quickly under pressure. He gets away from it. Dumps it off. Chris Carson will have a nice gain after a play that looked blown up.
Pretty good awareness by Mason Rudolph. Kept the play alive. We talked about the bumps on his back. He doesn't have to see the rush. He feels it.
Off again to Washington. He'll get out to the midfield mark and move the chains for the Cowboys. Pushed out of bounds by Elijah Lee. Mason Rudolph tried to recover quickly and march his team downfield after throwing that interception for a touchdown a few minutes ago. Sounds like Austin Hayes stepped out of bounds on the near sideline, but not after getting 10 yards and another first down for the Cowboys.
In the catch and release offense, Rudolph has great hands in that he gets the ball, finds the laces, is ready to throw it very quickly.
Flags and whistles, and that's going to cost them some yardage.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, a first down.
Marcus Keys, the big left guard, who offensive coordinator Mike Yurcich calls the most talented we have when he's on.
And he's
still learning.
He's close enough to the football. He should not jump off sides. That happens with the tackles with an edge rusher. Shouldn't happen with an interior lineman.
That's only the third penalty of the game on the Cowboys. First and 15 now. Hand it off to Justice Hill. Pursued from behind by Elijah Lee, 9 for Kansas State. The junior from Blue Springs, Missouri, that leads the team in tackles, had 14 tackles in their game at West Virginia. He's the Big 12 Defensive Player of the Week in that one.
Kansas State does a nice job of maintaining gap integrity. That was a outside zone play, and they just kept stringing it out, kept leverage on their men.
Blake Jarwin's back in the game, 47. Flag on the field. In the vicinity of a holding call.
Holding, number 71, offense. 10-yard penalty, still second down.
Brad Lumblade, the center for the Cowboys. Nothing kills an offensive drive more than repeated penalties.
Watch him right inside there. Let's see who he's matched up on. He's a former walk-on, the best communicator they have. And that, you know what, I'm not sure that was really a penalty, but unfortunately, anytime you get that jersey stretch, as you say, officials are looking for that.
It's the surest thing that's going to draw the flag is when that jersey starts to stretch on those shoulder pads. Rudolph pursued from behind and knocked down by Trey Deshaun. The 300-pound redshirt freshman taking the quarterback down.
Rolling on the field, that the runner was down by contact. Third down.
It's take a look right at the end of the play here.
Check that. That was settled.
He's down, and the ground caused the fumble, which is 10 out. So this is a third and 15. This is third and long. Huge opportunity for Kansas State to get a big stop. Pressure.
Incomplete. Not sure where that ball was even going.
Too, that could have been intercepted also. I think he just decided he had to get rid of it, threw it into the vicinity of the underneath crosser. That was a very dangerous throw.
Massive defensive stand for Kansas State, and Oklahoma State hurting themselves there, marching down the field, and the offensive penalties that slowed that drive down.
Talk about a change of momentum in the football game these last couple series.
Zach Seiner, the punter. Came after it. Got a piece of it.
No. As soon as he touches it.
And the ball will go over on downs to Kansas State. The blocked punt picked up and run with. But it'll be K-State's ball when we come back. Out of a little Pac-12 after dark on ESPN College Football. Jake Browning and the number 5 ranked Washington Huskies into Berkeley to play Cal. Streaming live on the ESPN app at Watch ESPN. Will there be a purple wave there in Berkeley tonight, as there has been here in Manhattan in this third quarter?
We take a look at this block. Watch, they take this guy out of here, which gives them only two people back here to block, and they're going to come like this off this edge. It's going to be very interesting to see how this thing works out, because I don't know if this was a planned block all along, but you see 46 Kirby come right off the edge there. They took a guy out of the shield. They didn't have enough people back there to block.
So the ball spotted after the blocked kick at the 38-yard line, and that is where Jesse Ertz and the Wildcat offense take over, leading by two. Hand it off. Alex Barnes gets to the outside. Flag has come in, though. Flag sitting right on the far numbers at the 30, check at the 41-yard line. Talk it over.
Personal foul, face mask, defense, 15-yard penalty out at the end of the run, automatic, first down.
This outside zone play has really done a number. Yeah, there's the face mask right there. Oh, my gosh, turned him all the way around, but he didn't even go down. He kept running. Pretty good job by Barnes.
So at 15 on, Abdul Beecham, the left guard for the Wildcats, came up limping after that play. He's gone off. And so we'll keep an eye on that as he works on the near side.
Oklahoma State needs some magic here. They need one of those turnovers. They've been a bend but don't break defense.
Jesse Ertz would get the outside on that left side with the stiff arm. Down to the 22-yard line. And a first down for Kansas State.
Jesse Ertz is sort of a magician. He just jumps around in there and he gets the outside. He's faster than you think he is. And he's got strong arms. He's got length to those arms for the stiff arm.
How about the block by Winston Dimmel, the fullback, 38 there, to seal that edge for him. So Kansas State down to the 22-yard line with a first and 10. Doing their thing, running the ball, grinding up the clock.
A lot of people in the box right now. Looks like a pressure blitz situation.
Ertz throws. Incomplete. Tried to get it to Dominique Heath. Little too short of a distance on the pass. He couldn't come back for it. Kansas, you know, most of this third quarter, it's felt like Kansas State has had all the momentum with a lot of things going on, and yet they only lead by two.
Right. This is one of those games that it may come down to who has the ball last, where are they in that last possession.
Beecham has just come back in at left guard for the Wildcats, so good news for them. He pulls, gets a block there that helps his quarterback get to the outside. And a flag comes in late. Going to get some more yardage on the end of it.
I love Ertz's patience. The offensive line is holding blocks and dominating blocks. A lot of times when an offense runs, the longer an offensive line.
After the play was over, personal foul, number 36. Defense, late hit out of bounds. Half the distance of the goal, automatic, first down.
It's Moncrief.
Moncrief, yeah. Yeah, that's in his way out of bounds. He's already taken that step. But as I was saying, the offensive line is holding those balls. A lot of times you're worried about that, being able to do that. Actually, the longer he waits, the better they get at creating angles and blocks.
Beecham tripped on his tackle outside of him. Scott France coming up when he pulled, and yet still got a chip block to open that inside lane for Jesse Ertz on that last play. So first and goal now from the 9-yard line. And Ertz inside the 5, down to the 3.
Right now they need some substitution on Oklahoma State's defensive front. They're not getting it done. They're getting overpowered.
That's one of the things that Mike Gundy says they've been able to do, is rotate two different defensive fronts in there, particularly on long drives. Right now looks like their starters are in, trying to find a way to keep Kansas State out of the end zone and make them settle for 3. It's second and goal. Touchdown, Jesse Ertz.
Cavalcade, people in front of him, does a nice job of picking his spot, finding his hole, and crossing that goal line.
That's K-State power football right.
That's
there,
exactly,
huh?
Right. This whole drive seemed like that.
So they're just confirming that the ball broke the plane before a knee or anything hit the ground from the replay booth. That is the hold up here, and they point at the kicker and say, we're good. So now Ian Patterson for the point after try to make it a 9-point lead for the Wildcats. Largest lead of the ball game for Kansas State. 6 plays, 62 yards. Jesse Ertz powering his way into the end zone, aided by 2 Oklahoma State penalties. College Football Hall of Famer, Coach Bill Snyder. In his 25th season heading up this Wildcat program, seeing his team go out to a 9-point lead, taking advantage of opportunities that they've created. The pick six earlier and the blocked punt that set up that whole drive, charged down the field.
Still coaching, whether it's on the sideline or anywhere. And they call him Stern, but they respect the heck out of him.
Kick through the end zone and a touchback for Oklahoma State to start with. Our Pacific Life game summary: Mason Rudolph, 21-29, throwing 280 yards, 3 touchdowns, but that one interception has cost them 7 points. And Jesse Ertz for Kansas State, fairly balanced attack for him personally, huh? And here's the key play in the game so far: the pick six that Duke Shelley took back for a Kansas State touchdown. 30-21 with 2.5 minutes to go in this third quarter. Now Mason Rudolph and the poke start at the 25. Rudolph's got a receiver far side. Chris Lacy will move the chains on their first toss. Now here's where it's tough, right? When you're on the road and you've made some mistakes and you've fallen behind, is you got to pick yourself back up and say, hey, we're not out of this. Look, plenty of time left and we're not that far behind.
Plenty of time left, but every possession counts. And when you know that Kansas State's going to run that clock, you know that I've got to score if I'm behind on every possession. Just a little shovel pass, sweep screen on the outside, just effort and energy from Jordan Willis. He gives it every single play. The energy, the focus that he has is legendary in practice, and he takes it into the games with him.
So sets up a 2nd and 12 for Oklahoma State. given near side to Carson. First down and more. They say he's out of bounds at the 49-yard line, just shy of midfield. But still enough to move the chains after the Cowboys were behind the chains there.
Out at the 49-yard line, first down, Oklahoma State.
Good call.
Carson brings back a spark, as we've talked about. He's bigger and just not quite as fast, but probably a lot more powerful than Justice Hill, the other tailback.
Rudolph's got a receiver far side. It's Lacy again. Good tackle by DJ Reed, but not until Lacy, the junior from DeSoto, Texas, moves the ball all the way down to the 34.
Lacy getting a big cushion out there from Reed, and right now you don't want to get beat deep, but watch out for the double move route. And getting that bigger cushion, he'll go down, fake the curl, DB bites, go right by him. Looks like one-on-one protection, like man-free situation.
They pick it up. Got a receiver running toward the end zone. Austin Hayes with the Cowboy touchdown. What a huge answer for Oklahoma State. Needed, and they quickly drive down the field and put it in the end zone with Austin Hayes getting his first touchdown reception of the season.
Let's take a look. Here he is right here. Just watch what happens. They run a double move route at the top of the screen, and then he just runs by the guy, and he's in the seam between the safety and the corner. Nobody there. But good vision by Mason Rudolph.
Ben Grogan kicks the point after try, and we're back to a two-point game near the end of this third quarter. Been a lot of fun things to talk about today here in Manhattan, but something not so fun that we want to take a minute and share with you. Kahari Lowry was the 15-year-old son of K-State associate men's basketball coach Chris Lowry. He passed away unexpectedly early on Tuesday. He was a regular fixture around the athletic program here, his loss being felt by so many. And we want to just take a minute and acknowledge the hurt that's going on here in the Kansas State athletic program over the loss and send our condolences to the Lowry family. Kahari Lowry was just 15 years old. Hard to talk about something like that on a beautiful Saturday afternoon like this and shift gears right back to football, but we do so.
It is. I've had that happen to a member of my staff, lost a child with special needs. And it's a very difficult situation, and one that you embrace as a department, as a family, as a college, really.
So now trailing by two, the 18th-ranked Cowboys kick it off. Matt Amendola taken by Byron Pringle. He's got some yardage. Just caught up to and wrestled out of bounds at about the 41-yard line by Derek Moncrief, or he was going to the house.
These two teams have scored more touchdowns on special teams in air than the nation in the past decade. And certainly you see some of the explosiveness right there.
Kansas State, one of the best in the country at punt and kick returns this year. Oklahoma State, one of the best in the country at defending punt and kick returns. So K-State got the better of that one. And good starting position for Jesse Ertz and the Wildcat offense, leading by two in this final minute of this third quarter. To Alex Barnes. All the way down to the 31-yard line before he's run down from behind and knocked down.
I'll tell you what, this is just dominance by the K-State offensive line. Nobody can get off blocks. They're just reaching them and then staying on the blocks and giving the running backs, Barnes or whoever carries the ball, just an opportunity to explode and accelerate through the line of scrimmage.
27-yard run for the redshirt freshman from Pittsburgh, Kansas. And we come to the end of this third quarter with the home team and the fans being cheered on by right tackle Dalton Reisner. Back and forth we go. Special teams plays, defensive touchdowns, offensive answers. We go to the fourth, separated by two here in the Little Apple. We go to the fourth quarter in Manhattan, Kansas. The home team, the K-State Wildcats, leading number 18 Oklahoma State by 2. 4 lead changes in this one. Alan Best with Mike Bellotti, Chris Button with you. The importance of this one, Oklahoma has already won this weekend. They played Thursday night. They beat Iowa State. Oklahoma State needs to win to stay within a game of their cross-state rival in the race for the conference championship. K-State looking to become bowl eligible this year with a victory, and also they have to win all of the rest of their games and get a lot of help to have any shot at the conference championship.
One of the things going to help them win today is doing a great job on first down, getting that second and 4, 5, or 6. It means you're being successful on first down. The third downs become that much easier to convert.
Kansas State well above their season's average in rushing yards per game today, and this whole fourth quarter still to go. Hurts will make the give to Charles Jones. He'll have the first down. Check that. That was Barnes back in there. I'm sorry. Alex Barnes having a big game.
Real question, and one of the things, in addition to the offensive line doing a tremendous job blocking, is with Jesse Ertz carrying the ball, or Jones or Barnes carrying the football, the defense doesn't know really who has the ball. Who can they key on?
Bill Snyder told us that he needed to do a better job of riding the hot hand among his running back rotation. The hot hand right now being ridden is Alex Barnes, the redshirt freshman, who's got K-State now at a second and short.
He's also the big power back. He's over 220 pounds, so he can wear on you a little bit.
Averaging 7.3 yards per carry this season coming into today, and he's done nothing to hurt that average today at all. Stacked up nicely and wrestled back to the ground. Vincent Taylor said, "You're not going past me." Taylor, the redshirt junior from San Antonio. And so now it's third down and short for Kansas State.
This is going to be a little interesting because third down and short, if it gets to fourth and short, 3 points only makes it a 5-point lead. So I think they're going to try and go for a touchdown, go for the fourth down conversion if necessary.
They've been very good at fourth down conversions this year.
A lot of people at the line of scrimmage for Oklahoma State.
Timeout called by Ertz. Want to talk about it? Didn't like what he saw. Play clock running down. No time to make an adjustment. They'll adjust during the timeout. 2-point ball game. K-State driving. Well, with all those really interesting scores coming across the bottom of your screen, be a great night to watch SportsCenter tonight after the day's football action wraps up. Pucci and Connors will have all the football highlights, plus the night in the NBA and NHL. Get you ready for NFL Sunday and everything else from this busy day in sports. That's after Washington Cal on ESPN. And, of course, you can stream it live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Third and short here.
I would take the runaway, make him throw the ball.
Not only got the first, he's almost to the end zone. They mark him down at the half-yard line.
Nice blocking up front. Like I said, I think you have to stop the run. You've got to add people to the box.
Oh, nice block there by Dimmel.
Dimmel, nice job of taking on the charging linebacker and opened up that hole. That parted like the Red Sea.
Box loaded there, but they push and push and push, and where do they spot the ball? No signal yet.
That's the rugby.
Touchdown.
Rugby scrum. Takes a while to unpile, see where that ball ended up. This is like the human battering ram. It's the quarterback, you know, it's the guy that you break down the castle wall with his head, so to speak.
Well, this offensive line went through some struggles in the beginning part of the season. They settled on a lineup now.
Yeah, it's just great push. Good low center of gravity by the offensive line. And look at those guys behind just pushing that whole pile, pushing the quarterback, which is totally legal with the new rules.
Dalton Reisner, the right tackle, told us that since about five games ago, they put this group of five together. They've really gelled.
Touchdown. Previous play is under further review.
All right, got to make sure he got into the end zone.
And, you know, this is the type of play, you know, Ertz used to be 6'5 when he started this. Now he's 6'3.
There's a good look at Reisner, who was the starting center last year, now moved to right tackle this year. He said this group has a lot of chemistry up front now.
Yeah, it's getting the guys together that can understand and play together. It's not always the five individual best, but it's the guys collectively that play together the best.
And this formation that we've seen from K-State with basically full push.
Yeah, the quarterback takes the brunt of this right to the head. He's trying to go over the top of the lineman, be pushed from behind by the tight end fullback type guys. And I think that shows that he got over the line. It looks as his helmet is in the end zone. The ball is falling pretty closely behind.
Again, you'd have to have indisputable video evidence beyond all doubt to change the call on the field. The call on the field is a touchdown.
Agreed.
So Jesse Ertz and the K-State offense drive down the field, pending the review and the point after try, to go back up by 9. Mike Gundy getting an explanation from some of the officials.
And Ertz is listed at 6'3", 212. He doesn't look that big in person.
Here's the call.
The review. The ruling on the field stands. Touchdown. The game clock operator, please reset the game clock. 12 minutes, 21 seconds. 12:21.
So far, I'll give K-State the A marks for crowd signs that we've seen this season. And Jesse Ertz into the end zone. Remember, that started with a good kick return. Talking about the special teams play. Then they went 58 yards in 7 plays, 3 minutes, 15 seconds. And the point after good by Ian Patterson. So back to a 9-point advantage for the home team. What can Oak State do to try and answer?
College football presented by K Jewelers. For 100 years, every kiss begins with K. And in part by Allstate, proud supporters of college football, it's good to be in good hands. And the new Volkswagen Golf All-Track, soon to be everywhere.
Now that looks good, doesn't it? That's the Call Hall Dairy Bar here on campus, serving products fresh from the university's herd of Holsteins. One of the more popular flavors, the K-State Purple Pride. And how about soldiers from Fort Riley? It's Fort Riley Day here at Bill Snyder Family Stadium. The U.S. Army's 1st Infantry Division, housed just up the road. They say some 25,000 people work there every day. And Coach Snyder says what those soldiers have done is so meaningful to me, the immense sacrifices they're making. They're so happy to have them here at the ballpark today. 37 push-ups.
I wonder if they don't have to do calisthenics tomorrow if they kept the game today.
Oklahoma State out to the 19-yard line where they take over. And a look now at the college football playoff rankings brought to you by Allstate. So Bama and LSU tonight. Clemson handling Syracuse. Ditto Michigan, Maryland. Texas A&M losing today. They were kind of the big controversial one, being over the top of Washington. That won't be any longer.
It'll tend to all work itself out as we keep going.
Doesn't it, though? It's just a first step. And, of course, the next rankings Tuesday night, 7 Eastern on ESPN. Mason Rudolph and the Pokes down by 9. And handed off to Justice Hill, but clipped on the far side by Dante Barnett with a speedy pursuit up from his safety spot.
They love the veteran. He's a leader back there in the secondary. Key playmaker for them. Also, the pressure's mounting on Oklahoma State. You talk about possessions. They're down 2 scores in this game. They've got to find a way to score, not knowing how many more possessions they're going to get in this quarter.
All right, one of the big keys coming into the game, Coach Mike Gundy talked to us about. Make the most of every possession because of the way K-State keeps the ball and runs clock. Rudolph under pressure, gets away. Downfield. Intercepted. How did DJ Reed come away with that ball?
He became a receiver once the ball was in the air. This is actually a much better throw than anticipated. We talked about Mason Rudolph having the bumps on his back. He's got his capability to keep the play alive. But watch the corner go up and steal this ball. I'm not sure whether or not Seals actually saw the ball or lost it at some point. Really felt like the ball was going to be uncatchable. But I'll tell you what, Reed didn't think that. He said, that ball's mine.
So DJ Reed, the sophomore from Bakersfield, gets another pick. And the third turnover of the day by the Cowboys gives K-State back the ball at their own 32-yard line. This is Jesse Ertz. Out to the 41-yard line. Ertz set a career high for rushing yardage in last week's game at Iowa State. He's topped it today.
No surprise. I'll tell you what. When Coach, we ask Coach Snyder, what's your quarterback? You recruit him. Do you want runners or passers? He said, we want runners, which surprised me. The guys have to be able to run the football. That's the basis of this offense, having a dual threat slash running quarterback.
Stood up as he tried to get the corner on the far side. It's Trey Flowers with the stop. But he got enough to get the first down, and they'll move the sticks.
All control, move the chains, keep it away. Play keep away now.
You know, Bill Snyder, age 77. How does a guy at that age relate to young players of today? Well, you know, he has their respect. That was when DJ Reed came to the sideline a minute ago.
They got too aggressive a high five or jump up in the air, but that's a sign of love and respect.
Barnes, wow, what a crack at the end of that one. Jordan Stearns and Alex Barnes.
I'll tell you what's impressing me, though, is Jesse Ertz's decision-making. He's making all the right reads and when to keep the ball and when to give the ball. But, yeah, that's an exclamation point on the end of that play.
Second and four, K-State for the Wildcats 49.
Oklahoma State got to be talking strip, rip and strip. Second guy to the ball has to be thinking punching that ball out now.
That's something they've done really well this year is create turnovers. They're a plus 10 in the turnover margin. Today, they're three in the hole. Barnes again powering up to near first down yardage. We talked about this a little bit earlier, but want to come back to it. The offensive line for K-State struggled a little bit earlier in this season. Bill Snyder talked to us about, you know, players getting on the job experience, some of them this year. And as they've gone and settled on this starting five for now five consecutive games, Dalton Risner, their right tackle, talking with us here when we met with him on Friday, about how much chemistry as they drive to try and get the first down. That's going to depend on the spot. How much chemistry this group has pulled together and what a difference it's made for this team.
Well, it's the collective issue, being able to think as one.
Didn't get it. Fourth down.
Well, let's see. You're ahead, but typically they have chose to punt the ball away in this situation earlier. The line, the group on the field is pleading, let's go for it, we can do this. But cooler heads prevail, unless it's a fake.
We saw him fake the field goal try earlier. It did not work. But Nick Walsh, the punter, is on to try and flip the field position. He killed one earlier inside the 10-yard line against Oklahoma State. This one's a little high, floating, short. Takes a good bounce. Really good bounce. And they'll knock it down at the 6-yard line. Field position flip accomplished. Cowboys, your ball. Number 5 Washington visits Berkeley to take on Cal tonight. The Pac-12 After Dark, ESPN, 10:30 Eastern. Streaming live on the ESPN app and on Watch ESPN. Certainly, Chris Peterson's got the Huskies at full speed.
They're hitting on all cylinders. They play offense, defense, and special teams very well. Cal's going to score, but I'm sure they can slow down the Husky offense.
Jake Browning will lead them into action later tonight. Cal undefeated at home this year in Berkeley. As So Oklahoma State trailing by nine. Mason Rudolph dumps it off underneath. That is Jalen McCleskey, who will have enough yardage to move the chains, though a flag has come in. That's in the defensive backfield. And judging by the motions of Jordan Willis, 75 there, they're discussing a penalty on Kansas State. Scott Campbell's our referee.
Personal foul, targeting number nine, defense. The previous play is under further review.
That's Elijah Lee. Had a conversation with him about targeting yesterday when we met with him.
Right, and he talked about the fact that he's never really sure. He tries to hesitate. You know, it looks like he goes low. I don't, you know, from that angle, as the receiver's dropping down. Let's take a look here. Well, they both, there's three helmets that collide together. And I'm not sure when the offensive player ducks down, you know, what happens when you've initiated. But
his helmet did strike the other helmet with the crown of it. But when we talked with Lee about this, asked him with these targeting rules and so on, he said, yes, you do have to have that momentarily flash of thought of how do I hit this guy as he's coming at you full speed.
I think Kendall Adams actually is more guilty of targeting right there than Lee was.
And now remember that the penalty has been called, and the rule is, if in question, it is a foul.
Yeah, it's difficult. I've heard defensive coaches talk about the strike zone. Basically, from the shoulders to the knees as where you want to target. But when a receiver starts to lower his shoulder to initiate contact, it really becomes difficult for the defensive player to figure out, what am I going to do? Do I protect myself? Yeah, there's three players that strike with their helmet, and they all drop.
I'll say we're going to get the call here and find out for sure.
After review, there is no foul for targeting. It's going to be first and 10, Oklahoma State.
And I agree with that, and here's why. If you watch as he's going in, he's turning his shoulder and going low to try and hit that strike zone while the runner is being tackled by another player.
I agree. I think that's a great no call. I think it's the right call in that situation.
All right, so first and 10. Ball at the 18-yard line. 8 minutes to go and counting. Rudolph under pressure. Steps up. Lofts it downfield. A wide open receiver. James Washington off to the races. 10-5. Touchdown, Cowboys. How do you lose James Washington? They did.
Well, that's the response that you need, obviously. One, Mason Rudolph buys time in the pocket. Take a look on the outside. It's just a straight post route. No help over the top. Can't match his speed in space.
82-yard touchdown reception for James Washington.
The key to the play, Mason Rudolph stepping up in the pocket to avoid the pressure.
Ben Grogan for the point after try.
These extra points become key.
Yes. So now that's a two-point game. Remember, K-State missed one early on in the game, bounced it off the upright. Well, this tells you what Oklahoma State's offense is capable of. That was, what, 82 yards? That wasn't even his long touchdown reception of the season. It was 91. Forget the complex formula for offensive efficiency. 92 yards in two plays and 31 seconds for Oklahoma State to put seven on the board. Two-point game here in Manhattan.
Two plays, 31 seconds.
Yeah. Wow.
Okay.
That'll accomplish your lot when you're coming from behind.
That helps.
No shortage of enthusiasm in the student section on a beautiful, beautiful November day here in Manhattan. Their team still leads, but the margin for error has gotten significantly thinner. Amendola squibs it. Taken at the five, now the four. That's a great run back. Pringle all the way out to about the 29-yard line before he stepped out of bounds.
Well, here's James Washington. Watch him for a second. Then I want to freeze it as they get going here.
All right, right about right here. Now watch, the quarterback steps up in the pocket. That buys the time, and then this route right here eats up the free safety, which is the only help for the corner. That point is when the receiver starts to separate. Ball's thrown very well, so Mason Rudolph stepping up, and then just the explosiveness of James Washington. In the open field, very few are going to catch him.
Washington, the junior from Stanford, Texas, leading the Big 12 in yards per reception, and getting 82 on one there is not going to hurt that average. Nice running play on first down for Alex Barnes, and we check downstairs with Chris.
Al, at Oklahoma State was the only team to recruit Washington, and I spoke with them earlier this week. He said, I want my story to resonate with other high school athletes, that you don't have to go to a big 5A school. He went to a very small school. He said, if you're talented enough, someone will find you. And it was actually because he had high school basketball dunks on his highlight reel that the Oklahoma State coaches loved him. They said, if he can jump and catch like that, we want this guy.
It's not unusual for college football coaches to look at high school basketball recruiting film of a lot of their players as Ertz tries to convert and will get knocked down, and it brings up third down.
The fact that James Washington has great character and great grades doesn't hurt any either.
Yeah. So third down here and a long two, maybe three. Make it three. They spot the ball right in the 35. They need the 38. So this big here for K-State.
Well, and this is a obvious run-pass option opportunity. Ertz is a great decision maker, but he's certainly going to look to run first, and then, depending on the coverage he gets, he'll be ready to throw.
Not going to get it. Vincent Taylor. Again, for Oklahoma State.
Nice job of playing off the block up front. Didn't have a chance to really see anything opening up. Ertz is very patient, but in this sense, the patience cost him.
Closing out games in the fourth quarter have been a topic of conversation for the Wildcats. Three and out when they lead by two. And now Walsh punts it away. He's got that forward roll going on his kicks, doesn't he? That's going to go all the way down to the 20-yard line, and that's where the Cowpokes will start with this next offensive possession. Another Big Ten game tonight on ABC. Number 10, Nebraska, and number 6, Ohio State from Columbus. 7-1 for both teams. So particularly with Texas A&M losing today, a lot of college football playoff discussion around the outcome of this one. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC, streaming live on the ESPN app, and watch ESPN.
Ohio State's offensive line has not played well. They haven't protected JT Barrett very well. I think they're going to get healthy against Nebraska.
I know this, we got a lot of fun football to flip back and forth and watch tonight. So from the 20-yard line, Mason Rudolph and the Oklahoma State offense go to work. They pull it down, nobody to go to. Nice recovery there by Reggie Walker to knock it down. 51 for K-State.
I'm not sure Oak State is built to be patient, but obviously they just need to play for a field goal at this point, but odds are they want to go for the big score.
Big running room. Breaking tackles, Chris Carson all the way out to the 41-yard line.
And you run the risk. We talk about the importance of every possession. If you don't get a score here, you may not see the ball back with the way Kansas State has run the ball and the effectiveness of their offensive line today. Oklahoma State has to capitalize on this possession, whether it be a field goal or a touchdown.
Trying to overcome a 3-turnover day so far for the Cowboys. Still only trailing by 2. Rudolph throws, got a receiver, and a first down into Kansas State territory. That's Austin Hayes, 17. And the ball down to the 45-yard line. They come up to go quickly. That is a nice job by Mason Rudolph to find a way out of trouble.
Absolutely.
Something either.
That scrambling got them in a decent situation. Plus 4.5 or so on first down. They're moving the chains very well.
And he lost a shoe. Play clock running. Game clock running.
Got plenty of time for them. This group, they're going to have 5 seconds to get that play on.
Outside to McCleskey. First down. Jalen McCleskey moves the ball now down into the 30-yard line area of Kansas State for the Cowboys.
A little bit better energy right now for the Cowboys on the field. That quick strike last time helped them. They're playing with some confidence right now.
Is it too much of a pun if I said they found their giddy up in this fourth quarter?
No. They might have put the spurs to the pony. I don't know.
Justice Hill down to the 25-yard line. It's been kind of a quiet day for Hill. This is eighth carry, but just 37 yards on those eight carries. But the freshman who's been the rushing leader for the Cowboys.
Got the feeling he's getting a little bit worn down this time of the season. And we're really excited to see Chris Carson come back to keep him fresh for these situations in the fourth quarter.
With 2.5 to go. Hill again. Lots of yardage. First down. Down to the 17-yard line. Oklahoma State with a solid drive. And Justice Hill, the freshman from Tulsa, moving the ball.
Do you take time off the clock? Set up a field goal? Do you consider taking timeouts if you're Kansas State? There's a lot of chess match going on right now.
Kansas State not known for quick strike offense.
No, but Oklahoma State taking a lot of time right now, more so than they need. Looks like they're going to be content to try to run the clock a little bit here, too.
Inside two to go. There's Carson. Inside the five. Touchdown, Oklahoma State, and the lead.
Or we can just let them score easily, and then we get the ball back. Great run by Carson. Not to take anything away from him. That's tremendous fight. Good blocking up front. You see him get through the line of scrimmage, pick his hole, and then really, literally carry two would-be tacklers into the end zone.
So Chris Carson puts the Cowboys out on top. He and Justice Hill tag teaming with a lot of running yards on that particular play. And now, because of the gap on the scoreboard, they'll go for two here. Direct snap to Jalen McCleskey, number one. He'll throw. And good for two. Throws it to Rennie Childs. And it's a 6-point lead for the Cowboys.
Calling that a throw is very nice. It was sort of a shot put right there, I think, but still effective.
Did it work?
Yeah, it did work.
Well, that was 8 plays to go 80 yards. Took 3 minutes and 49 seconds off the clock. And now Kansas State finds themselves trailing in this fourth quarter. 1:46 and 2 timeouts to try and get back on top. And need a touchdown to do it. Can't get a field goal.
Was it last year's game that was decided at the very end?
Yes, it was.
Last play of the game. We talked earlier about who has the ball at the end of this game might have to score at the end to win. Kansas State, can they get all the way down? Are they built for this type of a situation?
So the Cowboys, despite turning the ball over 3 times in the game, come back to lead late in the fourth quarter. Now what kind of a kick return can they possibly get? Amendola will kick, sorry.
Yeah, depending on whether they want to kick it deep. They did. They're going to give him a chance to return it.
Pringle with the one. Got a gap! Out to the 39-yard line. And the special teams play gives the Wildcats much better field position.
I was going to say, whether you squib kick it or do you kick it deep and give them the chance for the return. Here's another look. Pringle watching him right there. Just sees it. He senses that hole. He's off to the races. Nice job of tackle by the kicker, I believe, to save a potential touchdown.
Byron Pringle leads the Big 12 in kick return average. So for the second time today, sets his team up in good field position. The last time they converted, let's see what they do this time. Minute 39 to go, two timeouts for the Wildcats. Ertz with time, but no receivers. They step out of bounds at the 45-yard line.
Plenty of time because they're at midfield almost now. So the reality is, but you're still talking to your receivers about first down, out of bounds, or touchdown. So you want to keep, you don't want to stress that timeout level. Mass substitution by Oklahoma State, trying to get fresh people on the field and or match up to personnel groups.
So spotted at the 46, at a second down and three for the Wildcats. Dump off the inside pass to Jones. Got the first down. And down to the 45-yard line. Clock will stop briefly while they spot the ball, then it starts up right again.
Three-man rush that time. Screen call, typically you'd like to have that into a blitz situation, but still worked against the three-man rush.
Ertz will pull it and run. Trying to pick up a block, he gets one. 25, down to the 20-yard line.
You know, when you only rush three people, you're supposed to be playing a zone, and that is designed to keep eyes on the quarterback so he can't make those type of runs. Credit Jesse Ertz with just an outstanding play.
A minute to go. Trailing by six. K-State with the ball into the red zone. Dumps it behind the intended receiver, Deontay Burton. Back, and incomplete.
Back to a four-man rush, but Oklahoma State is tired. Those guys mounted very little pass rushing. Ertz mad at himself right there. He sort of sidearmed that ball. He had a chance to step into the throw, make it more accurately.
So second down and 10. 50 seconds to go. Still two timeouts. Need a touchdown and a successful point after kick.
Point after kick. Talked about it.
Throws across the middle, complete. That's Isaiah Zuber. Clock running, 43 seconds to go.
They have timeouts. They're going to flirt with this clock just a little bit.
From the 12. I hear whistles. Timeout, Oklahoma State. Saw something they didn't like. Ran on the field to signal the timeout. So the Cowboys stopped the clock.
The snap, timeout, Oklahoma State. First of the half, 30-second timeout. For the game clock operator, please reset the game clock to 31 seconds.
And welcome to those of you watching. Number three, Clemson beat Syracuse 54-0. Alan Best with Mike Bellotti, Chris Button in Manhattan, Kansas, where number 18 Oklahoma State just scored to take the lead on Kansas State. Now the Wildcats driving, have a third down and one deep in Oklahoma State territory. They need a touchdown and a successful extra point to try and win the ball game. 31 seconds to go, two timeouts for the Wildcats. Nothing doing. Vincent Taylor makes the stuff, and timeout called. It's going to be fourth down for Kansas State, and they lost that yardage, crucial timeout. Lost yardage there.
Great job at that point. Zone read, and it was the right read by the quarterback, but the defensive line for Oklahoma State stepped up right there, stopped that play before it got started.
K Kansas State has won its last six at home. They're grinded out style. Been very successful today. Oklahoma State's turned the ball over three times, but their high-octane offense has come back to put them in position to win the game. Oklahoma State trying to keep pace with their cross-state rival Oklahoma, who already won its Big 12 game earlier this week.
We'll take a full timeout.
So Oklahoma State trailing by a game in the race for the conference championship. Other action happening around the conference falling in their favor so far today as well, with Baylor being in a lot of trouble to TCU, trailing by some 26 in the fourth quarter. Here's the Big 12 picture as we go through today's play.
We've talked about Oklahoma can control their own destiny if they win out. Oklahoma State can keep themselves in contention with the win here today. To me, it's fourth and four right now. I'm going to tell you, if I'm on defense now, I'm going to make Jesse Ertz beat us with his arm. He's proven he can run the football. I've got to stop the quarterback run, which means I got to add somebody to the box. You're probably going to be a man-to-man on the outside. I'd still rather make him beat us with his arm.
K-State with four wideouts, one running back. Fourth down and four. Ball game right here. Jesse Ertz, the Wildcat quarterback. Can he convert? Here's the throw. Got it! First down! Isaiah Zuber, ball at the nine. 20 seconds to go. Could have spotted at the eight. Ertz stopped at the three. And a timeout signal for the Wildcats with 10 seconds left to go.
They do have one timeout, so you can continue to run the football.
That was their last one they just used there.
Oh, that was the last one.
Yes.
Okay.
So 10 seconds to go, and you're at the 3-yard line. And what can you do from here with knowing you've got no timeouts? You got to throw it, right?
You got to throw it, I believe. Yeah, it's second and three. You have two plays here at least. We're going to talk about this. If you run it, you've got to get in the end zone. So the quarterback decision-making in this case becomes crucial. If he's got a run pass option at all, which I don't think they will, but if he does, they got to trust his judgment. Otherwise, you can get two plays off at least if you throw the ball.
But he's got to be sure, because if he goes for that run and gets stopped,
no question,
they can spike the ball in a hurry. But
you heard about that Brett Favre play where they told him you have to throw the ball, you have to throw the ball, and he scrambled and ran into the end zone.
Yeah.
Had he been tackled, the game would have been over. He won the game. Now, the reality is, I agree. I think two shots into the end zone is what you would call as a coach. What happens if they're covered, he feels pressure, he starts to scramble. He does have to, cannot get sacked. Cannot get sacked.
Second and goal, 3-yard line. Down by seven, 10 seconds to go and no timeouts. Oklahoma State will call a timeout. You saw how they lined up. That obviously prompted the Oklahoma State timeout.
Yeah, I think what happens is the 3-by-1 set. You can talk about what can happen, what they typically have run from this personnel group, and sort of say we still have to cancel the quarterback. You got to get after the quarterback in terms of pass rush, but you cannot run by the run. Stop the run first, cancel the run, attack the quarterback. And I don't know what kind of coverage you're going to play, though, but watch for rub route type things. When you get 3-by-1 set, you've got the potential for somebody going to the corner of the end zone, a crossing route between the middle two receivers to shake somebody free.
It'll be a full timeout.
Well, it has been a back-and-forth game. Kansas State raced out to a 13-0 lead early. Oklahoma State came back. They traded the lead four times. Start of this second half, really, it was Kansas State who had the upper hand. It looked like they had a lot of things in control. But Oklahoma State's high-scoring offense went down the field 92 yards in two plays to take the lead. And now K-State driving back, a kick return. Got them good field position to start this attempt to win the game. And here we go with second and goal and 10 seconds left in the ball game.
It's the scary part about playing a mobile quarterback, one who's very comfortable running the ball. You have to be very careful on your pass rush. Keep him in the pocket. Squeeze the pocket. Combination route down here at the bottom of the screen.
Ertz throws. Stop just short of the goal. 5:04 left. There's a flag. There's a flag in the back of the end zone. This is a big call here, depending on who this is on.
Pass interference, number 9, offense. The pass crossed the line of scrimmage. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Still second down.
So that will back them up 15 yards. Now the question about the 10-second runoff, here's how the rule reads on that. If a team commits a foul that causes the clock to stop immediately, and that foul didn't cause the clock to stop, the clock would have kept going had there not been the interference penalty. So that's why there's no 10-second runoff there. So they bring the ball back, and one last play to decide the game. It's going to be from the 18-yard line, win or lose, right here. Timeout, Oklahoma State. They're last.
Oh, the excitement of these things.
Timeout, Oklahoma State.
Once again, they're good.
30-second timeout. Well, again,
they're going to look at the formation that they saw, talk about it. The problem right now is Kansas State may very well might change that formation so that it's not what Oklahoma State is prepared for. But obviously, this ball has to go into the end zone. You got to cover everybody and look for multiple seam routes. Your best receiver one-on-one. And I think that would probably be Pringle. They talk about him being their biggest weapon. I think Dominic Heath may be the scariest guy because he's a sort of a jitterbug. But I think right now the 6'2 Pringle in the end zone, I'd put the ball up for him when in doubt, or for Deontay Burton. They're talking about him being a veteran and a possession guy. Not a lot of speed, but you don't need speed here at this part of the field.
The other side of the coin, Oklahoma State's defensive front getting some pressure, and Kansas State getting the block, giving Ertz time to find that receiver and execute the play.
Yeah, I think one of the things that I've seen and we've talked about is that this group up front for Oklahoma State, when they're motivated, they can squeeze that pocket. And watch really for Vincent Taylor. He's the one guy that has the athleticism, speed, and strength to really be a force as a pass rusher.
Taylor, 96 for the Cowboys. So last play of the game here, barring a defensive penalty, Jesse Ertz and the Wildcats from the 18. Let's it go. Intercepted. Ball game over. Cowboys win. What a ball game in Manhattan today. Oklahoma State, number 18, escapes Manhattan with a victory to stay just a game behind Oklahoma in the race for the top spot in the Big 12.
Two teams and two coaches that respect each other and played a whale of a game.
The final throw into the end zone, picked off by Jordan Stearns and Mason Rudolph, and the Cowboys will have a happy ride back to Stillwater, escaping with a 43-37 win, that 92-yard quick strike scoring drive, proving to be the difference in the game. Pressure was coming, had to get rid of it. Wound up finding a crowd of people in the end zone.
Nobody can shake themselves free. Just a three-man rush with an add-on. The add-on guy is the one that gets the shot on Ertz as he tries to throw the ball.
Let's go to Chris.
Coach, how were you able to come up with a stop there at the end?
Well, our defense rallied. We gave up a few yards more than I wanted to. It made me a little nervous there, but fortunately, we played the pick play down there effectively, and then they got the pass interference call. You know, it was interesting. If it wasn't for that, the clock would have ran out. So worked to their favor just a little bit, but I couldn't be any more proud of our guys. When you come on the road and turn the ball over three times, really hard to win. But we found a way, so I was proud of our team.
You talk about the turnovers. What does it say about the composure of Mason Rudolph that he was able to lead those drives after those two picks?
Well, he played pretty average up to that point. But, you know, it's interesting. He played better after that than he did before. So, you know, you have to love that about the kid. He's found a way to win a lot of football games. But overall, everybody played good. I thought our offensive and defensive coaches made some really good adjustments.
I appreciate the time. Go win tonight.
Yeah, thank you.
Cowboys get a win in a very difficult place to get a win, Manhattan, Kansas. They move to 7-2 on the season, 5-1 in the Big 12, and a game behind Oklahoma, who's undefeated in conference play. Tonight at 8 Eastern, Nebraska and Ohio State here on ABC. Final score from the Little Apple. Oklahoma State 43, Kansas State 37 in what turned into a thriller in Manhattan. For Mike Bellotti and Chris Budd and Alan Bestwick, so long from Kansas State.